Hello and welcome to number 3 in this series of 4 snapcasts looking at practical chemistry for GCE, specifically lower sixth or AS GCE chemistry. And here we look at planning. You're allowed to bring in your notes and textbooks, of course. And typical of what you see on this next slide, one is given plenty of direction and assistance. Right, let's have a look at this first planning exercise, converting ethanol to ethene. What is a dehydration reaction using a catalyst? Aluminium oxide. Ethene looks like so. Sorry, ethanol looks like so. And what happens here is the OH comes off here, and the hydrogen comes off the adjacent carbon. And they produce water. Then this bond comes around, or these two electrons come around to form the pi bond, which gives us the principal product, ethene, which comes off as a gas. So take your time and take in all the information provided here and the directions here. And when you're ready, have a go at these two questions. And when you're ready, here's the answer to part A. Clearly we don't want the ethanol mixing with the catalyst until the catalyst is sufficiently hot. So we can't just simply put the ethanol in, otherwise it'll come in contact with the catalyst. This is why we soak it in ceramic fiber or mineral wool or rock wool. Initially there's a lot of air here in the test tube and indeed in the delivery tube. Initially the test tube here will be entirely filled with water, an inverted test tube. Don't concern yourself with this Bunsen valve at this stage, not necessary in this experiment. No reference was made to it. It's to prevent suckback of the liquid back into the hot test tube, which would clearly cause the glass to crack and possibly cause a small explosion to take place that would be very dangerous. Let's take a look at the mark scheme answer. And there I think you'll see we had everything on the diagram. And part B, did you get this? You would record the mass of the test tube and the mass of the dry ceramic fiber. Next you would soak the glass fiber, sorry, the ceramic fiber or glass wool or rock wool with ethanol and re-weigh it. The difference between those two weighings would give you the mass of ethanol used in the experiment. Moving on to the next question. Pause and have a go. And when you're ready, here are the answers coming up. So the catalyst needs to be hot to be active. Now clearly, when you're ready and you've got the catalyst sufficiently hot, you then want to drive the ethanol off as ethanol vapor, which will go through the hot granules of aluminium oxide and undergo dehydration. Moving on to the next question. Do pause, please, and have a go. So explain why the first few bubbles given off are not collected. Initially, this delivery tube should not be put underneath the inverted test tube of water because there's a lot of air in the test tube and in the delivery tube. So the initial bubbles should simply be allowed to bubble off here. One main hazard of this procedure is the possibility of water being drawn back into the heated tube. It's known as suckback. Explain why water may be drawn back into the heated test tube. Did you get this answer? If there is a drop in pressure in the reaction test tube, that would cause suction back into the hot test tube. That could cause, as a result of the person, for example, stopping heating the test tube. So the moment, it is important that the moment you stop heating here, that the delivery tube then is removed from the water trough or beaker. As it cools in here, pressure will drop, and as pressure drops, you get sucked back towards the test tube. They're suggesting removing the delivery tube, or indeed the stopper, entirely removing the stopper. If you see any sign, you should keep a careful eye, if you see any sign of the liquid beginning to backtrack towards the test tube. Moving on. This is the so-called Bunsen valve, which we look at in a little bit more detail in a later question in this particular snapcast. But if you like to pause, you can take in the information here. Moving on to the next part, pause and have a go, please. And here are the answers coming up. Hydration is to add water. Dehydration is to remove water. The equation then, producing ethene and ethanol. And were you able to calculate the maximum volume of ethene that could be made or could be produced at 20 degrees centigrade in one atmosphere, in other words room temperature and pressure, from 0.69 grams of ethanol? First you need to convert the mass into moles. You divide the mass by the relative molecular mass of ethanol, which is 46, and you get 0.015 moles of ethanol. You see from the equation that 1 mole of ethanol gives 1 mole of ethene, so you'll also get 0.015 moles of ethene. Now what volume would that occupy? Well, 1 mole of any gas occupies 24 cubic decimeters at room temperature and pressure. So you multiply the 24 by the number of moles, which is 0.015, and you get 0.36 dm cubed. Multiply that by 1,000 to change it to cubic centimeters, 360. Pause again, please, and have a go. And here are the answers coming up. As I suggested earlier, some of the ethanol is likely to come over unchanged by the catalyst. That's one likely cause. A test then to confirm the presence of an unsaturated chemical, such as ethene. A mark for saying bromine water, stating the colour of the bromine water to begin with. This is the colour, described as orange-brown usually. And it becomes colourless, disregard this, if you put in here the delivery tube and you bubble ethene gas through bromine water, it goes colourless and clear. So we start with an orange-brown clear solution of bromine water. We end up with a colourless clear solution. And apparently when you test the test tube of gas collected in the way we saw by the downward displacement of water, there's no ethanol present. How come? Well, the ethanol, remember, at room temperature and pressure is a liquid. It's got a much higher boiling point than ethene. So as it enters the cold water, it condenses and dissolves in the water. Remember that ethanol, with its OH groups, can hydrogen bond with water molecules. It will cool, condense, dissolve. A reminder of the chemistry involved here. This is ethene. Here's bromine. Bromine is orange-brown, but the product 1,2-dibromoethane, seen here, is a colourless product. You may recall from a different snapcast in the series We often choose cyclohexene to represent the carbon-carbon double bond chemistry of an alkene, because cyclohexene is a liquid, it's easier to store and use liquids rather than gases. Cyclohexene reacts with bromine to form this product, which is also colorless. This shows what cyclohexene looks like with its double bond, carbon-carbon double bond. That completes the first question. Let's move on to the next question. This, remember, there are two practicals given in the same week each year, practical one and practical two. This was practical two in that particular year, 2004, involving hydrated copper sulfate and determining the number of molecules of water of crystallization in hydrated copper sulfate. Typically it's 5, but there's no reason why in a particular instance some of the water may not have been lost. So one might expect the value of X to be 1, 2, 3, 4, or 5. Again, you'll have your textbook and your notes to use if you wish, and indeed past paper questions and mark schemes if you wish. And typically, again, you're given direction and help in planning your experiment. So pause and take in the information here. When blue hydrated copper sulfate is heated, if it was pentahydrated, it would be 5H2O, and when that is heated quite strongly, it changes into anhydrous copper sulfate, and the water of crystallization is driven off as steam. This is a solid and it's white in color. This is blue. So when you've taken in the information, let's move on to the first few questions. Pause and have a go, please. And here are the answers coming up. You want an evaporating basin, Bunsen burner, tripod, and gauze. So you have to have both the tripod and the gauze to get a mark, the Bunsen and the basin to get a mark. What does anhydrous mean? It comes from the Latin. Anhydrous means without water. Hydrated means with water of crystallization. So anhydrous, you must get both, contains no water, and mention that we're referring specifically to water of crystallization. One observation made during the dehydration process: the blue crystals are going to turn white. This picture here shows us the opposite. This shows the addition of water to white anhydrous copper sulfate. You may notice here that some of the water turns to steam. That's because this is a very exothermic process, as the water combines with the anhydrous copper sulfate to form blue hydrated copper sulfate. The reaction is exothermic, and the heat turns some of the water to steam. So a number of observations there. We're going back the opposite way. We're taking the blue hydrated copper sulfate, heating it, so it's an endothermic reaction, and producing white anhydrous copper sulfate. Pause, please, and have a go at this. 2 points required for part three here. What do you think the 2 points are? If there are 2 points, don't necessarily go for 2 points. State more rather than less, as long as you're not writing anything that's incorrect or irrelevant. And how would you ensure, using weighings, that all of the water was removed? What are they looking for here for the 2 marks? And during the heating, some material in the evaporating basin may spit out. How could such spitting be avoided? 1 mark for that. Here are the answers coming up if you're ready. So again, pause and take in the information. Learn from any mistakes you might make. Simply weighing before and after. The difference will be the water released from the hydrated crystals. And heating to constant mass, a very common answer. Heat and weigh. You heat, cool and weigh. And heat, cool and weigh over and over. until you get two wings the same. And to avoid spitting, the only way to avoid that is to slow down the rate of heating. Heat gently. Again, pause and have a go, please. When you're ready, here are the answers coming up. So if we're using X rather than 5 here, then you're going to give not 5, but XH2O. Calculate the mass of water formed. So it's the mass of the hydrated crystals. You take away the mass of the anhydrous crystals, the difference is the mass of water. The number of moles of water, when you divide the mass by the relative molecular mass, the relative molecular mass of water is 18, and that gives this number of moles of water. Calculate the number of moles of anhydrous copper sulfate. This is the number of moles, this is the mass, 1.05. And if you work out the relative molecular mass of CuSO4, that's anhydrous copper sulfate, it's 160. Again, you divide the mass by the number of moles. Do recall in this rearrangement triangle that links mole, mass, and relative molecular mass. In a rearrangement triangle, you cover what you want. So if you want moles, you cover mole and read what's left. And that tells us that mole is the mass divided by the relative molecular mass, which is what you see in each of these cases, the mass divided by the relative molecular mass. Continuing on this, pause and have a go. You've got the number of moles of this, you've got the number of moles of that, so you can work out the ratio of the number of moles of copper sulfate to the number of moles of water, which will give you the value of X. And try this one as well before looking at the answers, please. This is really a comprehension question. You're given all the information. Anhydrous copper sulfate, when heated, decomposes to give copper 2 oxide and sulfur trioxide. So you take the CuSO4 and you produce these chemicals, CuO and SO3, and you test to see if the equation is balanced. And this is very straightforward because it's balanced immediately. So here are the answers. We had this number of moles of anhydrous copper sulfate, this number of moles of water. This in fact is there for a ratio. What one does at this stage is divide both numbers by the smaller of the two numbers. This is the smaller of the two numbers. And the ratio comes out to be 4.74, 5 to the nearest whole number, 1 to 5, so the value of X is 5, and it was indeed CuSO4.5H2O, known as copper sulfate pentahydrate. And there was the equation. Moving on. Pause and have a go, please. Going back to your GCSE chemistry, copper oxide's a base, copper sulfate's a salt, base plus an acid gives a salt plus water. Think about that in constructing your equation and what the other reactant will have to be. Here are the answers coming up. The gas SO3 is an acidic gas. It will dissolve in the moisture of universal indicator paper, forming an acid, sulfuric acid, and that will turn the litmus paper or universal indicator paper red. SO3, you'll have come across in the contact process in GCSE. Another observation you would make, perhaps more straightforward, is that the copper, if we go back to the previous equation, you can see that CuSO4 is white, and hydrous copper sulfate, that is white, and copper 2 oxide is black. So a change from white to black as far as the solid's concerned. In terms of the acid-base reaction, you'd use sulfuric acid. So you get a base plus an acid gives a salt and water. And the salt copper sulfate is made partly from the base, copper oxide, and partly from the acid, sulfuric acid or hydrogen sulfate. Okay, moving on to the third plan in this particular snapcast. Pause and take in the information here, please, and have a go at A, part one. So here's the answer to A, part one coming up. This is the best diagram here. You've got your tripod. You use what's known as a pipe plate triangle when you're using a Bunsen. Pipe plate triangle looks something like this, and the crucible rests on it like so, though the gauze is shown in this instance here. You see here, this is the typical way of showing the pipe plate triangle. This is what a crucible looks like over here, with the crucible lid on top. Fairly straightforward to get those marks, I think. Pause again, please, and have a go at this. Here the answer's coming up. Clearly, whenever you're using a Bunsen and working with hot apparatus, one needs to be careful not to touch the apparatus while it's hot. And when the experiment is finished, leave plenty of time for the apparatus to cool down before returning it. The two weighings, you need to have the mass of the crucible on its own, in other words, the empty crucible, and then the crucible plus the carbonate. And by subtracting those values, you can get the mass of the carbonate used in the experiment. What is heating to constant mass? Well, you heat, cool, and weigh, and you repeat that heat, cool, and weigh over and over until you get two consecutive weighings the same. Pause and have a go again, please. So 4.9 grams of the carbonate yielded 2.33 grams of the metal oxide. Pause and see how you get on here, please. And here are the answers coming up. All we needed to do to get the mass of CO2 was to subtract 2.33 from 4.90, and you get 2.57 grams of CO2. So in terms of the metal oxide, got the metal carbonate, it's decomposing to give the metal oxide plus CO2 gas. We've got 2.33 grams of this, and we've got 2.57 grams of this, and you've got 4.90 grams of the metal carbonate. To convert the mass of carbon dioxide to moles, you divide that mass, 2.57, by the relative molecular mass of CO2, which is 44. And this is the number of moles of CO2. The number of moles of the metal oxide next, well, that was 2.33. Again, we need to divide the mass by the relative molecular mass, but we have a problem when it comes to MO. We can't work out its relative molecular mass because we don't know the relative atomic mass of M, in that we don't know the identity of this group 2 metal. But what we can do is, we know that the oxygen contributes 16 to the relative molecular mass, and we give the symbol X to the relative molecular mass of M, then we can produce this sum. Now, where did the 0.058 come from? Well, it comes from the fact that when the metal carbonate up here decomposes, up the top right here, notice that it produces the metal oxide and the carbon dioxide in what we call equimolar amounts. For every 1 mole of CO2, you get 1 mole of MO. So if this is the number of moles of CO2 formed, we've definitely got the same number of moles of MO. So we're able to write, this is the number of moles of MO, and this is also the number of moles of MO, its mass divided by its relative molecular mass. And after that, it's down to your mathematics to be able to solve this equation for X, and it comes out that X is the value 24. And magnesium has an atomic number 12 and a relative atomic mass 24. So that gives us the answer to this part. Try the other parts, please. Now, when you're ready here, the answer's coming up. So the metal with the relative atomic mass 24 was magnesium. The test for CO2, mark for saying lime water, and that it turns milky. Strange, in GCSE, I think that they like you to use the term cloudy rather than milky, but here they're using the term milky themselves, so hopefully they accept both milky or cloudy. This is what happens if you bubble CO2 here in this picture on the right. We can see lime water, which is normally colourless and clear like water, starting to go cloudy here, or milky. And hopefully you got the equation for the reaction of CO2 with lime water. Here's lime water, calcium hydroxide. Calcium hydroxide is only slightly soluble, so lime water is a very, very dilute solution of calcium hydroxide and water. If you bubble CO2 through it, you get calcium carbonate, which is insoluble, comes out as precipitate, and water. Moving on. Pause and have a go, please. You should know that a metal carbonate, or indeed a hydrogen carbonate, will react with an acid and it'll give three products: a salt plus CO2 plus H2O. What does the word standard mean when we talk about a standard solution of hydrochloric acid, for example? State an indicator which would be suitable for the titration. What type of titration is this? There are four types of titration when it comes to an acid with an alkali. We could have a strong acid with a strong alkali. We could have a strong acid with a weak alkali. We could have a weak acid with a strong alkali, and a weak acid with a weak alkali. With a weak acid, weak alkali, remember what the pH graph looks like. If we're adding it does matter in terms of the graph which we're adding to which. Let's consider that we're adding an alkali to an acid, a weak alkali to a weak acid. Then we're going to get a graph that looks something like so. It's got no vertical section to it, so no indicator is suitable for a weak acid, weak alkali titration. Remember that for a strong acid, if we're adding if we're adding a weak alkali to a strong acid will be way down here somewhere. We're adding a weak alkali, we get a graph that looks something like so. If it's the other way around, if we're adding a strong alkali to a weak acid, then it's looking something more like that, and so on. We need to choose an indicator which changes its colour within the vertical part of the graph, and that's what will dictate the indicator that's suitable. If it's a strong acid, strong alkali, then we get something that looks like so. Now, in terms of the main indicators that one should remember, you should remember that phenolphthalein changes its colour somewhere up in this range. Methyl orange changes its colour somewhere down in this range here. If I transfer that information to this graph, methyl orange would be okay there, but phenolphthalein wouldn't be good for that particular one. When it comes to the strong acid, strong alkali, both indicators would be satisfactory. Now, what are we working with here? We're dealing with a strong acid, hydrochloric acid, and we're dealing with a metal carbonate, which would be a weak alkali. So we have a titration of a strong acid with weak alkali, this type of setup here. So on the basis of that, methyl orange would be the best indicator. But I suppose in this particular reaction, the particular carbonate is not defined, unless we assume that we carry forward the fact that it was magnesium carbonate from the earlier part of the question. Here are the answers expected. They did accept also phenolphthalein, but for the argument I gave, methyl orange would be the best one. A standard solution refers to a solution of known concentration. And there you get your metal carbonate and acid gives a salt, water and CO2. On to the fourth planning exercise. Again, plenty of information and direction provided. Pause and have a go at this, please. So a bit like the previous question where we had hydrated copper sulfate, we were determining the value of X in that question. Here we're driving off water crystallization from barium chloride, hydrated barium chloride, getting anhydrous barium chloride and water. And we have to determine the value of N. How many water molecules do we have per mole of salt? This is what hydrated barium chloride looks like, a white crystalline solid. And this is what hydrated calcium chloride looks like. Remember that colour is a feature of transition metals. It's not surprising that these are white, being non-transition metals. They are both group 2 salts. Okay, when you're ready, here's the answer to A part 1. We've seen something like this before, haven't we? The crucible, the pipe clay triangle, the tripod, and a Bunsen to heat it. Moving on. Pause and have a go. As well as safety glasses, what else is important by way of safety? These very same questions came up a short time ago, so here are the answers. And again, mass of the crucible should be determined first, then the mass of the crucible plus the hydrated salt. Or it's mentioning the fact you can use the tur button. You could put the crucible onto the balance, hit the tur button, and then add your salt. Heating to constant mass, heat, cool, and weigh over and over until you get two consecutive weighings the same. Pause and have a go, please. So you've got your BaCl2, NH2O. That's going to break into or decompose into BaCl2 and NH2O. We've been told here that we start with 2.24 grams of this, and we get 1.89 grams of this. To work out the mass of water, all we need to do is subtract the mass of the anhydrous salt from the mass of the hydrated salt. To get moles, we divide the mass by the relative molecular mass and so forth. So when you've tried it, here are the answers coming up. The difference in these two masses is 0.35 grams. You want to change that to moles of water. You divide the mass by the relative molecular mass of water, which is 18. Gives us this number of moles, or more accurately this number, 0.019. What's the number of moles of anhydrous barium chloride? If we divide the mass, 1.89, by the relative molecular mass of BaCl2, the anhydrous salt, which is 190, we get this number of moles. So we have twice as many moles of water as we have of the anhydrous salt, so that gives us the ratio 1 to 2, or more precisely this. So the value of n, clearly we've got is 2. Try these other parts, please. Chemical test for water. And here are the answers coming up. Two marks here, so you need to mention the fact that you start with, as you see here, white anhydrous copper sulfate. You add the water and it turns blue. That's reflected in this top line here of the answer. This is one possible answer. You could, as an alternative, use anhydrous cobalt chloride, which is blue in color to start with, and it turns pink when you add water. And the equation needed? If we don't know the number of molecules of water crystallization, we can use X. And the dot here is significant. It's the notation for showing water crystallization. Pause again and take down the information, please. These are all relatively straightforward, but do stop and think and get the best answer you can. Here are the answers coming up. Simply filter, as shown here. This is a sophisticated, proper way of filtering. You've got the filter funnel here. You've got your suspension here with the insoluble product. Glass rod is used to direct the liquid correctly into the funnel. And your residue here, this, in this case the silver or the as it says here, the silver chloride would be collected there as the residue. You could also centrifuge it, and that's shown here. Centrifuge spins the test tubes and the solid by centripetal force is forced to the bottom of the test tube, and the liquid then can be poured out, and you've got your suspension, your solid at the bottom. How would you dry it? If you're not in a hurry, then the simplest way to do it is with a desiccator. You've got a wire mesh here. Underneath you put a drying agent, something like anhydrous calcium chloride, and you set on a dish your product to be dried. And you place the lid on the top. The drying agent dries the air in here, and then the air is quickly dried, or the damp product quickly dries in such an atmosphere. You could also use a laboratory oven, which is shown here, set at a moderate temperature well below the melting point of the solid you're drying. And the equation here for the reaction between silver nitrate and barium chloride, both of these are soluble. This is insoluble and this is soluble, so we have here a precipitation reaction. The silver takes the chloride, the barium takes the nitrate, and silver chloride is a white solid. Remember how that is used as a test for halide ions? Just a bigger diagram of a desiccator spelt with one S and two C's. The lid produces an airtight space inside the desiccator, perforated mesh on which your dish goes with your damp solid, and then below you've got your desiccant, so-called desiccant or drying agent, such as anhydrous calcium chloride. On to the next planning exercise. This is the fifth, I think. We're looking here at the chemistry of ethanol, ethylene glycol, and glycerol. Ethylene glycol is the old name. What would the proper name be for this chemical? It looks like ethane, where we have removed a H from each carbon and replaced it with an OH group. This would be known as ethane 1,2-diol. And then this is glycerol. What would the proper name of glycerol be? It looks like propane, where you have taken a hydrogen off each of the carbons and replaced it with an OH group. It's known as propane -1, 2, 3 dash triol. The tri for three OH groups. So we've got an alcohol with one OH group, an ethanol, an alcohol with two OH groups in the glycol, ethylene glycol or ethane 1,2-diol, and an alcohol with three OH groups. These OH groups are capable of hydrogen bonding between these alcohol molecules or between the alcohol molecule and water, for example. So pause and take in the information and direction here. And here's the first question coming up. Have a go at both parts of A here. When you're ready, here are the answers. So you'd have a burette, you'd run it out into some suitable container, like a beaker, for example. You'd need to have a stop clock to record how long it takes to run a specific volume out. The more viscous, the thicker or more viscous the liquid, the longer it will take to run out a specific volume. And the second part here, notice you have to get the flow rate in cubic centimeters per second. So you'd measure the volume of liquid in cubic centimeters to start with and divide the volume by the time in seconds. So for example, if you recorded how many seconds it took to deliver 10 cubic centimeters, so let's say it took, for example, 15 seconds to run out 10 cubic centimeters. If you want to get it cubic centimeters per second, then clearly you divide the 10 by 15. So it would be 10 over 15. That's clearly giving cubic centimeters divided by seconds. And that would be your answer then. Pause and have a go, please. If you're ready, here are the answers coming up. Testing your maths out more than anything. So it was 2.6 cubic centimeters per second, or 60 seconds in a minute. So to change it to minutes, you multiply by 60, you get that, 156. The density of the ethanol was 0.8 grams per cubic centimeter. So to change this to grams, you multiply the cubic centimeters by the density, 0.8 grams per cubic centimeter, and we get the mass of 156 cubic centimeters, namely 124.8 grams of ethanol. Now we want to change it to moles per minute. So we change this mass, 124.8, to moles by dividing by the relative molecular mass of ethanol, which is 46. So you divide 124.8 by 46 and you get this number of moles per minute. Pause again, please, and have a go. When you're ready, here are the answers coming up. So a hydrogen bond, the hydrogen bond, it's where hydrogen is bonded to a highly electronegative atom. It's considered that fluorine, oxygen and nitrogen, when attached to a hydrogen, may result in hydrogen bonding, not with chlorine. Chlorine is not considered sufficiently electronegative. It's where hydrogen acts as a bridge between two electronegative atoms. This is a hydrogen bond here, for example. All the way from there round to there is a hydrogen bond. The hydrogen here is acting as a bridge between two electronegative atoms. In this case, they're both oxygens. Remember, any of these particular ones over here, fluorine, oxygen, and nitrogen. Hydrogen is acting as a bridge between two electronegative atoms, holding one by a normal covalent bond and the other here by an electrostatic attraction. The lone pair, the oxygen, has actually got two non-bonding electron pairs, and they are being drawn towards the delta positive charge there on that hydrogen. This diagram shows the same thing. This oxygen here is worth looking at because you can see that a hydrogen bond is forming with that. It's forming between that oxygen and a hydrogen on an adjacent molecule. But that oxygen is also attached to this hydrogen, which goes on to hydrogen bond with the oxygen on another molecule. So lots of hydrogen bonds formed there. We see that each OH group is capable of forming hydrogen bonds with two other ethanol molecules. This diagram shows hydrogen bonding that could take place when ethanol is added to water. Here's a water molecule, here's an ethanol molecule. Well, here's an ethanol molecule which is already hydrogen bonded to this water molecule. But let's look now at the specific definition that your syllabus gives for hydrogen bonding. So you have to say that hydrogen is bonded to a highly electronegative atom for a mark. It's attracted to the lone pair on an adjacent molecule. So reference to that lone pair is important. And this last part suggests why glycerol has a greater viscosity than glycol, which in turn has a greater viscosity than ethanol. You can see how you're going from one OH group in the ethanol to two in the glycol to three in the glycerol. So more OH groups results in higher, more bonding, more hydrogen bonds between the molecules, and as a result the liquid becomes more viscous, less runny. Pause and have a go at this, please. So here's the answer coming up. Either of these approaches. When the relative molecular mass of a molecule increases, it means it has more electrons, and when it has more electrons, it's more polarizable, giving rise to stronger van der Waals forces. But van der Waals forces are very weak compared with hydrogen bonds. So where you have the two, it'll be hydrogen bonding that predominates, or that has the dominant effect. So either of these are possibilities. Choose two molecules that have the same number of OH groups, maybe one each. Vary the size of the molecule and see if you get the same kind of difference taking place. And of course you won't. Pause and take in the information here, please. If you were to rub your hair with a comb and then hold the comb near to water, which is would normally be streaming down like so, the water you will see is bent. It's attracted towards the comb. So have a go at answering part one here, E part one. Here's the answer coming up. And you can see they're looking for a very technical type of answer here. One might say that a polar bond is one where electrons are unevenly shared, but that wouldn't do according to the mark scheme answer here, so learn this particular answer. The centres of positive and negative charge for a mark do not coincide. But here's what a molecule looks like, a water molecule looks like. Here's the bonding pair of electrons, and you can see it's not equally shared. Clearly the bonding electron pair between the hydrogen and the oxygen is drawn very strongly by the oxygen and lies much closer to the oxygen's nucleus than the hydrogen nucleus. This has created a so-called dipole or a polar bond with a delta positive on the hydrogen, delta negative on the oxygen. Next question, or next part of the question, pause and have a go at this. It's because they want you to state that the oxygen is more electronegative than the hydrogen. That's what results in the bond being polar. And being more electronegative, it's greedier for the bonding pair of electrons. And this is how the water molecules would orient themselves towards the charge on the cone. So if this was the positive end where electrons had been rubbed off, creating a positive end to the cone, the delta minus on the oxygen would be drawn towards that, opposite charge is attracted. If this was the end of the cone where electrons had been rubbed onto the cone and developed a negative charge, then we would have the delta positive ends of the water molecules directed towards that end of the cone. On to the next question, the sixth of eight in this particular snapcast. Pause and take in the information. Sodium hydroxide comes in the form of pellets and flakes. Here we see it in the bottom left, as it exists as flakes of sodium hydroxide. Sodium hydroxide is also known as caustic soda. What's anhydrous sodium sulfate used to do? It's a drying agent, isn't it? Sodium hydroxide and carbon dioxide. In GCSE you learn that CO2 is very soluble in alkalis, especially strong alkalis. And sodium hydroxide is strongly alkaline, and the CO2 will dissolve in the sodium hydroxide. And here we have a specific volume of CO2 gas in a syringe. And when the plunger is pushed in, the CO2 is going to pass its way through the sodium hydroxide. Here's the first part of the question. Pause and have a go. Well, this takes you back to year 10 or junior chemistry. Very straightforward. When you've had a go at both parts, here are the answers coming up. You need a reaction flask. You could use a thistle funnel or a tap funnel like this to add your hydrochloric acid. The CO2 then will come out through the delivery tube, and you can collect it by upward displacement of air, because carbon dioxide is denser than air. And we're using, you see, limestone chips, form of calcium carbonate and hydrochloric acid. Marble chips, calcium carbonate and hydrochloric acid. A metal carbonate reacts with an acid to give a salt, CO2 and water. This will come off as a gas. The next question, pause and have a go. Here are the answers coming up. Anhydrous sodium sulfate absorbs water, or water vapor from the air, from entering the tube. So if we go back to the diagram again, the CO2, we won't be able to push the CO2 through the U-shaped tube unless there's an outlet here. So we need to be able to get the air out in order to get the CO2 in. So we have no choice but to have an opening here. The problem is that air then could come in, damp air. And sodium hydroxide, as well as absorbing CO2, is described as a deliquescent solid. Spelled that right, deliquescent solid, which means it absorbs moisture and then proceeds to dissolve in it. So this would give us a falsely high reading if any water vapor, any damp air got in. So we need the air to get out, but we can't have any damp air come in, and that's the role of the anhydrous sodium sulfate. If air makes its way in this direction, as it will, at least the anhydrous sodium sulfate will remove the dampness from the air, and therefore no water will be taken up by the sodium hydroxide. Right. That's part two, the reaction of CO2 with sodium hydroxide. It did tell us that you got sodium carbonate, and you should be able to reason that water was the other product. And how would you modify the apparatus to ensure that the carbon dioxide is absorbed? Simply adding another U-tube containing sodium hydroxide. So you go from that setup, in other words, to this setup. where you've added a second tube with sodium hydroxide. But this is important. It would mean that both tubes would have to be wed before and after to check the total amount of CO2 that had been absorbed. Pause again, please, and have a go. Here the answers coming up. So you could add one with lime water on the end. So if we go back to the previous diagram, if we put in here yet another tube in there, not doing this very well, but filled with lime water, by the time you've got to this point here, you would hope that there's no CO2 remaining in the air, and you would hope then that the lime water does not turn milky or cloudy. Well, the difference in these two masses comes out to be 0.18 grams. That's the first part of the answer. You should know that at room temperature pressure, a mole of any gas is 24 cubic decimeters, or 24,000 cubic centimeters. We had 100 cubic centimeters, so 100 cubic centimeters would be expected to be this number of moles. If you divide 100 by 24,000, that'll give you the number of moles present in 100 cubic centimeters. So we have, remember this rearrangement triangle here, which relates mole to mass and relative molecular mass. On this occasion, unusually, we're looking for the relative molecular mass, so we can cover what we're looking for and read off what's left. Relative molecular mass is the mass, which is 0.18, divided by the number of moles, which is 0.0042. And that gives us the relative molecular mass, which isn't exactly right. We expected it to be 44, but it's within reason, within range of what we expect. Pause again, please, and have a go. Ammonia is extremely soluble in water, and if you add it to sulfuric acid, well, it's going to dissolve immediately and react indeed with the sulfuric acid, NH3 and H2SO4. That's an alkali with an acid that's going to give a salt. And the salt will be ammonium sulfate. What do we need to do to balance this reaction? Our equation, we put a 2 in there. So pause and have a go at this, please. Here's the answer coming up. You could use a syringe on its own to bubble directly into the sulfuric acid. It says if the apparatus is sealed, then one mark is to be taken away. So it should be in an open container like shown here, a beaker filled with water with the acid, and then pass the gas directly into the sulfuric acid. You'll have wed the beaker with the acid beforehand and then afterwards, and the increase in mass will result from the absorption of ammonia by the sample, or by the sulfuric acid. Pause and have a go at this. And here are the answers coming up. So it's ammonia plus sulfuric acid. The equation we had a moment ago. And to test for ammonia, if you take, as you see here, a glass rod that has been dipped into concentrated hydrochloric acid, that will be giving off fumes of hydrogen chloride. And when hydrogen chloride gas meets ammonia gas, they form a white smoke of ammonium chloride. That's produced as a gas which then sublimes to form a solid, a white solid. Here you see what happens when these gases meet. White smoke is formed. Or indeed in this test tube here, I think you can see a white smoke has been produced inside. We're on now to the penultimate planning exercise. Pause, take in the information here and have a go at A part 1, please. So we have a metal carbonate and an acid gives us salt, water and CO2 gas. Very similar to one of the earlier questions. Here's the answer coming up. We'd have a reaction vessel, conical flask perhaps, with a stopper, a delivery tube connected to a syringe. You would have the acid in here to begin with, but not the carbonate. You would remove the bung, rapidly add the metal carbonate, and put the bung back on immediately again. This would begin to bubble, the CO2 would rise, and this plunger here would move outwards as the gas collects. So your metal carbonate, your hydrochloric acid, your reaction vessel, delivery tube and syringe. Pause again and have a go, please. Just one mark and nothing very complicated expected here. How would you know when the reaction is finished? Several possible answers. When you're ready, here's the answer coming up. Or answers. You tip the solid in and quickly replace the bung, basically, is what they're looking for. Because this is in brackets, not absolutely needed. Key thing in pink here, quickly replace the bung. How would you know when the reaction's finished? The most obvious thing is there's no more bubbling or effervescence or fizzing. Or perhaps all the solid has disappeared. Or if maybe you're able to watch the plunger and particularly watch the calibrations, and when you see that the reading is remaining constant, that's a clear sign the reaction seems to have stopped. Pause and have a go. What's the problem with passing the carbon dioxide through water and collecting it by downward displacement of water in a gas jar or test tube? And why isn't the carbon dioxide going to be pure, even when collected using the syringe? And for your weighings, if you're ready, here are the answers. Carbon dioxide is soluble, so you lose some of the CO2 in the water, and your reading, the mass or volume of CO2 produced, is going to be lower than it should be. And even when you collect it with the syringe, remember at the start, this is air in here, and there's air in the delivery tube. So when the gas CO2 comes off, it's actually pushing air out from the reaction flask, and it's going to be contaminated by air, and all the gas is normally present in air. The weighings, very straightforwardly, you take the mass of the test tube on its own, and then the mass of the test tube plus the metal carbonate, and subtracting these gives you the mass of the metal carbonate being used in the experiment. Pause again, please, and have a go. We've seen one exactly like this before, giving the metal oxide and CO2. You're starting here with 0.28 grams of this. And you're getting 80 cubic centimeters of this. Now this is at 20 degrees C in one atmosphere, which is considered to be room temperature and pressure. And one mole of gas occupies 24 cubic decimeters under these conditions. So you can change the first thing you'll have to do is change the 80 cubic centimeters of that should be under the CO, shouldn't it? You'll have to change the 80 cubic centimeters of CO2 gas to moles. Now once you've found the number of moles of CO2 gas, you can see from this equation that you get the same number of moles of MO as you do of CO, and proceed on that basis. And finally identify M. And when you're ready, here are the answers coming up. The number of moles, well, if you divide the volume, 80 cubic centimeters, by the volume of a mole of gas, which is 24 cubic decimeters or 24,000 cubic centimeters, that gives you the number of moles of CO2 gas. Calculate the number of moles of MCO3. Remember how MO and CO2 are produced in equimolar amounts according to that equation. So you get exactly the same number of moles of MO. Calculate the relative molecular mass. Well, we know the number of moles of MO. We've worked that out as 0.00334. We know the mass of MO. Now, the O of the MO contributes 16 to the relative molecular mass, but we don't know the identity of M, and we don't therefore know its relative atomic mass. But remember again the rearrangement triangle that links mole, mass, and relative molecular mass. We have mole here, we have mass here, and we have relative molecular mass here. And if you cover what you want, in this case we want the relative molecular mass, and read off what's left, relative molecular mass is the mass divided by the number of moles. So I've taken the mass, 0.28. Now I notice here it's talking about MCO3, but if we go back to that equation, MCO3 gives MO plus CO2. It's equal moles of everything. One mole gives one mole plus one mole. So whatever number of moles of CO2 you've established was present, you have that same number of moles of MO and of MCO3. So that's where this has been reasoned from. So going back to this rearrangement triangle, the relative molecular mass is the mass of the MCO3, which is 0.28, divided by the number of moles, 0.00333. And it turns out that the relative atomic mass of M is 84. That the relative molecular mass of MCO3 is 84. So we can take a look at what the C contributes. The C contributes, of course, 12 to the relative molecular mass, and each oxygen contributes 16. Three oxygens will contribute 3 16s, 48. That gives us a total of 60, leaving 24 must be coming from the M, and 24 we can identify that the metal in group 2 with a relative atomic mass of 24 is magnesium. Pause again, please, and have a go. Here, the answer is coming up. Metal carbonate gives a metal oxide and CO2. And you know the reaction is complete if you heat, cool, and weigh over and over until you get two consecutive readings the same. But the way we state this in chemistry is heat and weigh to constant mass. Remember that way of saying it, way of stating it, heat and weigh to constant mass, or heat, cool, and weigh to constant mass. And the last part, if you take the mass of the metal carbonate to begin with and you heat it to constant mass, you're left with is the mass of the metal oxide. If you subtract this reading from that reading, that gives you the mass of CO2. And if you have all of that information, then you can establish what you need. And we're on now to the 8th and final plan in this series, in this particular snapcast. Pause here, take in the information, and have a go at A part 1, please. Reacting a metal, like for example magnesium with an acid, gives a salt and hydrogen gas. Again, this should take you back to year 10, junior chemistry. Very straightforward. You'll have a reaction vessel. You put your metal in with your acid. You probably have the acid in first and have this all ready to be plugged in the moment you add the metal. You drop in the metal and very quickly put in the bung with the delivery tube. There's a lot of air in here, and as the hydrogen bubbles off, there'll be lots of bubbling. It'll push the air up here, and the plunger of the syringe will begin to move outwards, and you'll collect in here then a mixture of hydrogen and air. next part, pause and have a go at this, please. And here are the answers coming up. And we came across this earlier. Just tip the solid in quickly and replace the bung as quickly as you can. Two observations that could be made to show that the reaction has finished. Again, we came across this earlier. If you were looking at the syringe and you noticed that the plunger is no longer moving outwards, sure sign the reaction has stopped. Or no effervescence or fizzing. Or maybe the solid has completely disappeared. The metal, in other words. Another way of collecting hydrogen, you could collect it over water, the way you did it back in year 10. Hydrogen is less dense than water. It rises and it displaces the water downwards. The method of collecting it by, one would sometimes collect the gas by simply putting it into a boiling tube or a test tube like this. This would be unsatisfactory in this method because we're looking to record the volume, and clearly some of the hydrogen would be escaping out the sides here, and we have no way of seeing where the hydrogen level is because hydrogen is a colourless gas. The level of the liquid at least allows us to determine what volume of gas we've collected. And the same thing again, you have a lot of air in here to begin with, and as the hydrogen gas comes out here, it pushes the air out through the delivery tube, so it's going to be a mixture of air and hydrogen. What you can do to avoid that in normal circumstances is you could don't put the delivery tube underneath the test tube initially, and then when you have a steady stream of bubbling, then you could put the delivery tube under the test tube and collect pure hydrogen. But again, in this method, because you're trying to record accurately the volume of hydrogen produced, that's not suitable here either. Pause again, please, and have a go. Here's the answer coming up. So you'd need the mass of the container and then the container plus the metal. The difference between the two will give the mass of metal used in the experiment. Well, you see here you're getting 0.25 grams produced 44 cubic centimeters. What you could do is work out what 1 cubic centimeter would require. How many grams would you need to make 1 cubic centimeter? So what you do is you divide 0.25 by 44. And if you want to find out what 1,000 cubic centimeters or a cubic decimeter would require by way of the metal, then you multiply that figure by 1,000. And it turns out to be 5.68 grams of the metal. And calculate the number of grams of M that produced 24 cubic decimeters, which is a mole of hydrogen. So we simply multiply, we've got it for 1 cubic decimeter, we simply multiply the number of grams by 24 to get 24 cubic decimeters, which is this number of grams of M, and that will produce 1 mole of H2, which is 24 cubic decimeters. Recall that it is a group 2 metal, and recall this equation here, which is important, namely that 1 mole of M produces 1 mole of hydrogen. So the number of moles of hydrogen that we've just established indicates the number of moles of M as well. So, in other words, this is the molar mass of M, 136.4. And the nearest in terms of this particular group would be for barium, which has the relative atomic mass 137. So in terms of this bit, it's established that it's barium, 137 over 56. Have a go at these bits, please. you'd have the metal hydroxide. Given that it's a group 2 metal, it would have to be MOH twice, because M being group 2 would be a 2 plus ion, and the hydroxide ion is a single minus ion. And if that decomposes to give the metal oxide, what will the other product be? You have water, of course, and steam. So when you're ready, we'll turn to look at the answers. You would heat and weigh over and over until there's no further change in mass. Remember how we state that normally? Heat, cool, and weigh to constant mass. And for this part, you'd need to measure the mass of the metal hydroxide and the mass of the metal oxide. The difference in those masses would be the mass of the steam. And that completes this Snapcast, running for just over an hour and a quarter. Thanks for listening. And do consider using the other three parts in this series. Another one looks at observation and deduction exercises, running for just under 2 hours. And then there's one dealing with structured questions. Each paper has one structured question. And another looking at titrations and titration calculations. So good luck with your practical exams.